Welcome to the Living Well Church podcast, and thanks for tuning in today. Our mission as a church is to help people find faith in Jesus and a life of purpose and hope. You're about to watch a message that will challenge you, inspire you, encourage you, and most of all, point you to Jesus and the life of purpose and hope he has planned for you. So lean in and enjoy, and let God speak into your life.
So I'm starting the series, our new series, 40 Days. Joe's already said, but just to reiterate, every day we as the preaching team and leading team have written devotionals for each day. They will be sent out, they will be recorded. One of our faces you will get every morning. Aren't you fortunate? And we've recorded some verses, then with a thought and a prayer. I think you get them text to you and email to you, and they're on the Living Well Church website for you every morning. So that's just 40 days leading up to Lent, something that we're doing, and we are preaching into those things. For the next 7 days, you'll get devotionals based upon God's word. And so I'm kicking off this morning based on the word. So I'm going to start with a little bit of a story for you, something that happened a couple of weeks ago. And I arrived at work. I work here, not in this hall, but here in the building. And it was a little bit chilly and it was a little bit dark. And so me and the other people in the building, we were wondering what has happened here, because it is more cold than normal and it is darker than normal. And it was in the winter months, and we weren't quite sure what happened. So I phoned Penny, who is kind of the director of the preschool, and said, Penny, it's really dark, it's really cold, I'm not sure what's happened. She said, oh, it's probably been a power cut. Great. Little bit of backstory for you. I'm not a fan of the dark. I was one of those children that grew up with night lights pretty much all around, so I pretty much slept in the light. So I wasn't a huge fan of the dark, and I'm thinking, I hope we don't have to spend all day in the dark. She said, well, what you need to do is to go into the basement to check kind of the main power supply. I'm thinking, great. So now I've got to go into the dark basement, which is there down the stairs, and check the main power supply. I am equipped only with this torch, this tiny torch on my phone. So there I am, going down into the basement, going through. Then she mutters the words, yes, you need to find the boiler room. I'm like, I've never heard of the boiler room. And obviously, this is the darkest, coldest, most horrible place ever. And as I go through, the doors slam shut behind me. I've just got my little torch light on my phone. Anyway, it's not bad. I have Penny on the other end, so I don't feel quite alone. She then tries to describe to me the main power switch. This is hilarious because I cannot see anything. I'm a little bit confused. I'm a little bit scared. I'm not really sure what I am doing, but I have a little bit of light. So I'm shining this everywhere, trying to find the main power switch. Penny is slightly exacerbated on the other end of the phone, describing it to me, thinking, how has this girl not found this switch? And I'm feeling and trying to work out what switch she's on about. Anyway, I finally, it's kind of over here, the switch, so I'm just getting my place in, well, as I reenact this, I find it and I pull it up. And as I pull it up, everything illuminates and there's warmth all of a sudden. And I was like, and in an instant, confusion, fear, concern, doubt, all goes away. And I return back up feeling a little bit accomplished personally. But I just want to use, there's a lot in the Bible, there's loads of light and dark imagery. And I'm going to use that story because I think it's a little bit, I can use it as an analogy this morning of what sometimes life is like for us. We live in a dark world. Yeah, we only have to look at the man-made afflictions, what man does, the destruction we cause, to know that actually this is quite a dark place, unfortunately. We can reflect on our own lives and we know perhaps the sin that we've indulged in before. We know perhaps our bitter thoughts, our jealous thoughts, our hateful thoughts, our angry words, our temper, the lies we might say. We know actually the darkness that we say ourselves and how we contribute to it. We live in a dark world. And unfortunately, that is the state of the world that we live in. But in John 3, verse 19, it says this. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world. But men loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light. So it may be seen plainly that what he has done has been done through God. I love that first bit. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world. The first devotional that Marcus shared this morning read from John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. We live in a dark world, but when God sent his Son here, he sent light to be here. And Jesus also is the Word, as it says at the beginning of John. So the Word has come into our darkness and has given us light. And you know, when we read the Bible each day, it's almost like we've just got this little bit of light that helps us guide our path. In Psalm, I think Psalm 119, it says, Lord, your word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. So it's like when we read the word, we have this little glimmer of light that helps us in our confusion. In this dark world, we have this little bit of a guide unto our feet. But what I want to look at this morning is, this is what it says in Luke. If light has come into the world, then in Luke 11, verse 33, it says, no one lights a lamp and put it in a place where it will be hidden or under a bowl. Instead, he puts it on a stand so that those who come in may see the light. Your eye is the lamp of your body. And when your eyes are good, your whole body also is full of light. But when they are bad, your body is also full of darkness. See to it then that the light within you is not darkness. Therefore, if your whole body is full of light, no part of it is dark. It will be completely lightened, just like a light of a lamp shines on you. In here it says, therefore, I'll just read this, that your whole body is full of light. And what concerns me this morning when I was thinking about the word is maybe some of us are walking in this dark world with this tiny little lamp, this tiny little bit of the word of God that maybe we read one day then, and maybe read one day then, but we haven't allowed it to take root in us. We haven't allowed it to change our lives. We haven't allowed it to be applied to our circumstance. And therefore, it remains just as this little bit of light. But when we become to understand the word of God, when we become to really live by the word of God, it transforms us so that we are fully light. It's as if that light switch has been pulled up and our whole world is illuminated. And suddenly we can see really plainly, really clearly. For there's so much in the Bible. There's so much in the Bible about not worrying. There's so much in the Bible that we are child of God, affirming our identity. There's so much in the Bible about who we are, that we are loved. There's so much in the Bible about how to spend our finances, be good stewards of money. There's so much in the Bible about caring and loving our neighbor. Imagine if that word, we didn't just read it, it wasn't just a little glimmer in our lives, but it fully was we immersed ourselves in it to the point that we actually fully lived by it. And therefore we would stand here being children of the light, as it says in the Bible, not worrying when things go wrong, not being shaken when the storms of life come, loving our neighbours, being people of compassion, because we've allowed the word of God to fully take root. In Psalm 1, it says this, Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit at the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. You know, when we allow the word of God to really take root in us, we can stand firm in us, in it. And we don't wither. And whatever we do, it says in the word, prospers. So what I want to look at this morning is, how do we get from a place where maybe we read the Bible, we understand it a little bit, or we've read it in the morning, but maybe we go to work and then by the end of the day, we can barely remember what we've read. Maybe we read it a bit ad hoc or haphazardly. And actually, if I asked you, what was the last thing you read? You'll be a bit like, I'm not sure. If I asked you, how did it change your life? You'll be a bit like, I'm not sure. If I asked you for a key, like Bible verse that you know, you might be able to spill it off and I'll be like, how do you live by that? Is that true in that circumstance? I don't know. So I want to get from this place this morning where we're in a dark world with this tiny light to people who are children of light, fully living by what the Bible says. So I've got a few little practical things here that might help us. The first thing is the discipline of reading the Bible, of actually saying, I'm going to be really intentional about reading the Word of God. And some of you do this. Some of you I know love the scripture. You pore over it. You read it far more than I do. You know, you read hours a day. And I'm fortunate enough to have learned things from people in this church about the Word of God. But perhaps it is about clearing time in your day to really say, I'm going to read the scripture. And you know, that does take discipline. It takes real discipline. And I also would urge you to do that first thing in the morning. And the reason is that if you're stepping out of the house in the morning without even the tiny little bit of light into the dark world we live in, then you're stepping into, or you're setting yourself up for a day of confusion and chaos without any equipment from the Lord. And so I would say, spend some time in the morning. That might mean that you have to have a conversation with your spouse about how can we do that? When we've got to get the kids up in the morning, when we've got to try and get to work, how is that going to happen? Maybe you've got to take it in turns to have the kids for 15 minutes, then another, your wife have it for 15 minutes. Maybe you've got to think, oh, I literally set the alarm 15 minutes before I get out the door, and it is a case of quick shower, quick breakfast and go. Maybe you've got to think, actually, I need to send that alarm 15 minutes earlier. It is just being really disciplined and intentional about what you're going to do. Once you then start reading the Word of God, it's allowing it to take root. And that's a very different thing. I spent years probably reading the Bible and not allowing it to transform my heart. Because it says in the Bible, in Hebrews 4, that the Word of God is living and active. Now, I just want to pick up on that word, living. If it is living, that means that when we read it, it becomes alive in us. And in fact, in the Bible also says that all scripture is God breathed. Like the very breath of God is in these words. It's like the oxygen that we need is in the Bible. And this is a bit of a strange analogy, but hold with me here. If it's like the oxygen that's in the Bible, then our blood kind of carries round, the blood cells carry round oxygen within us. And I love the idea that perhaps scripture itself is almost like pumped alive around our body, just like the oxygen that's within here. It's the very thing that as Christians, it keeps us alive. It's alive within us. But so many times, particularly years ago, I used to read the scripture and I just used to read it, close the book, there we go, job done, and go off into my day. I didn't allow it to be kind of pumped around my body. I didn't allow it to be living and active within me. I didn't allow it to constantly shine out of every pore as I went through my day. And so Richard Foster looks at this idea of how do we get from this place of reading the Word of God to understanding and living in the Word of God. And Richard Foster talks about this concept of meditation. Now, I'm a little bit fearful of saying the word meditation, because quite often when we think of that word, we think of something a bit spiritual, something a bit like, I don't know, you know what I mean. I'm not going to kind of go there. But you know, we think of different things like connoting to that word. But Richard Foster talks about the idea of meditating simply as really taking time to think and to ponder, to spend, kind of with that word, with the word of God in your mind. And he gives some clear examples, and I'm going to go through the process with you this morning. You might find it helpful, you might find it really unhelpful, but it's really helped me in my Christian walk, so I thought I'd share it with you this morning. He talks about taking a very small part of the Bible, maybe just one verse. So for example, I'll use the verse Jeremiah 29 verse 11. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper, not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. And he suggests read that in the morning and then revisit it all the time in the day, but revisit it in small parts. So for example, if we just take, for I know, maybe that spells, as you go through the day, just think about the concept of for I know, that the Lord is saying to you, for I know. It's not for your mother knows the plans. It's not for your boss knows the plans. It's not for those people when you were younger who told you you weren't good enough or you wouldn't amount to anything. They don't know the plans. It's not your children. They don't dictate your life. They don't know the plans. It's the Lord. For the Lord knows your plans. And as you go throughout the day and you go through various circumstances and you go through various things, remind yourself, the Lord knows the plans. Let it take root. The next part, for I know the plans I have for you. Not plans just for anyone, but the plans for you. And these are clear, structured, preempted, thought about plans. It's not random thoughts. It's not spontaneous wanderings. It's the plans. And so perhaps when you go through your day and perhaps there's a frictional relationship that you are in, or perhaps there's something at work that you're dealing with, or perhaps there's an issue going on, perhaps you're trying to obtain a mortgage, perhaps you're trying to get a job, perhaps you're, I don't know, the kids are just driving you to distraction. Remember the verse, for I know the plans I have for you. There's something for you, it's in place, it's there. And apply that to those situations. The reality is, if we meditated, even just on that verse, if we allowed just that verse to take root within us, we wouldn't worry about tomorrow. We wouldn't allow what other people said about us to change our lives, to have an impact or an effect. Because we know, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. And yet, do you know what? I've done this week. I have had Jeremiah 29 verse 11 as my verse that I've been trying to equip myself. And it's funny how this week, Johnny and I have had endless problems with our mortgage. We're trying to sell our house this week. Things have been a bit of a roller coaster. And last night I woke up and my typical self would be like, Lord, right, I'm going to make a plan about what happens here. What happens if this happens? If this happens, I'm going to do this. And I'm there crafting the plan. And I'm reminded, for I know the plans I have for you, said the Lord. That's it. Stopped. Finished. Let the Bible verse take root. Let you be yourself, be like that tree by the stream of water, as it says in Psalm 1. Let the word of God come into you so that it's not just this tiny little bit of phone light as you stumble around the darkness in this confused and chaos place, but actually it's like this huge flick that's illuminating your whole life. And you go, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Job done. Go back to sleep. You know, but so often we live just with this tiny light. C.S. Lewis says this. Don't shine so that others can see you shine. but instead shine so that through you, others can see him. If I went into that basement with this tiny light, with three or four other people, those three or four other people would still be in the darkness. And that is the truth. If we only, as is, like, read the word, but we don't allow it to take root in us, then the truth is the people around us are still in darkness. It is only when we flick that switch within us, it's only when we fully become children of light, when this word becomes living and active within us, that we then become that lamp to enable others to see. And as C.S. Lewis is saying here, we're not shining so that people can see us. We're shining so that people can see Jesus. And I want to tell you this because this is the importance of the word in our lives. The importance of reading it. The importance of like absorbing it. The importance of allowing it to pump around our bodies and to shine out. So I want, this is not a long preach today, because I want to spend some time where just you, we pray, and we pray for the passion for the word to be kindled within us so that we're convinced that we need to know this word so that it shines out from us. So if you join with me, if you understand what I've said this morning, I'm sorry, it has been a bit confusing. There's a lot of dark and light symbolism. You might think, I don't understand your metaphors. You just sound like a crazy girl. That's fine. But... good, I'm glad you laughed at that. If you're understanding what I'm saying, and if you know, perhaps the Bible in my life is just this tiny light at the moment. And really, it needs to be this human illumination. Then I just ask you to stand, and I'm very simply just going to pray that over the next 40 days, our lives are transformed, where the word is something where we, from where we read it to something that actually is alive and active within us. So let's pray. Lord, we really, really thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you, Lord Jesus, that in this dark world, you sent, this is the verdict, that you sent light. And Lord, we stand this morning asking, Lord, let there be light. Lord, we stand here, gracious and humble, Lord, asking, Lord Jesus, that let us be that light. Let us shine so, Lord, that others can see you. Lord, make us make an intentional and conscientious effort to read your word, to devour it, Lord, to meditate on it, Lord, to inscribe it into our hearts, to allow it to change our lives so that we don't just become readers of the word, but we become doers of the word. So therefore, Lord, let us be children of the light. May we be those lamps that are set up on a hill, Lord, so that there is no darkness, so that other people can also live in the light. Lord, give us a passion for your word. Give us a longing for it, Lord. Let us realize that we need it to be alive, Lord. Lord, I pray that right now you feed scripture with spirit. And Lord, within us, Lord, there is change. So that we go away hungry just to pick up your Bible. Amen.